morning. Guys, we were in the previous class looking at some of the very fundamental aspects of earthquake engineering. We saw there are two kinds of waves, primary waves, secondary waves. Primary waves travel through the body of the earth. Okay, in general I will call as medium. In this specific case it is earth. And the other one is the shear waves, or they are the surface waves. They are predominantly there in the surface. The speed at which, or the velocity with which the wave transmits through the earth is proportional to the density of the medium. Okay, so if suppose the density is very very less, it is quite probable that this velocity which the wave is going to transmit is that much slower. We also saw that the waves get reflected and refracted because of the medium through which they pass. One of the areas where you have studied refraction of light. My glasses, owing to the density difference, bends the light to the way it wants it to bend. That is one thing. Of course, there's also other parameters like how spherical it is, blah blah blah. Okay, so refraction has an impact on the way wave transmits. Reflection also has a way by which wave transmits. Okay, now between the P waves and N waves, what happens is, I saw a lovely experiment where a professor demonstrated this by making his students stand in line. Okay, just imagine we are all standing in line and there's an excitation, somebody pushes. Okay, so I think you have done this in school, right? People will be all going in line, person from the back pushes, you can imagine what is going to happen. So essentially you are compressing the layers that make up the medium, in this case this is students. Instead of students, assume there are slices of earth and then you are pushing it. So when the push goes, it goes from one point to the other point. Second thing, it is the shear waves. Okay, so actually when you study the subject fluid mechanics, I came across a very nice definition. V.L. Streeter was the person's book, that book he had written. Fluids are medium that cannot resist shear stress. In other words, if you slide two layers, forces cannot get transmitted. Okay, now this surface waves are essentially shear waves. In other words, if suppose a medium is not able to take shear, for example water is there, water cannot take shear force, so the wave cannot go through the shear force. And again, the waves, the secondary waves, are vibrating in a direction perpendicular to the direction of motion. Secondary waves vibrate in a direction perpendicular to the direction of motion. You take a sheet and then you assume somebody else is holding it, and then I give it a jerk. The wave transmits in, guys, the one in the pink shirt. I don't want to repeat. Thank you. Now, when I'm giving it a jerk, the wave is moving from myself to the other person, but what is happening? The particles in the wave transmit in a perpendicular direction. So this is the secondary waves. There are other things, the Rayleigh waves and the Love waves, we'll go to that a little later. Okay. So first and foremost, we have been seeing what are the hazards which are happening. We are trying to see how to reduce hazards. Second, we saw what are the agencies that cause hazards: geological, meteorological, or it can be hydrological. These are the very big ways by which we defined it. And then we started a little bit on the geological aspect. Again, we are more looking at prevention or mitigation. Okay, suppose there is a way by which I can prevent a hazard, I am going to prevent it. Otherwise, I am going to take steps to mitigate it. We are specifically seeing it as an engineering problem. We are seeing this as an engineering problem where I engineer a solution which is going to be mitigating the problem. Okay, of course, there is also preparedness. We are doing all of this because to stay prepared. And the other stuff we will come a little later. So we were talking about tectonic plates. We saw that plates move up and down, and that is because there is a very nice hot molten, you know, substance on which plates can actually slide. They don't need to be anchored very tight. We saw about P waves, S waves. Love waves are a kind of interaction in the sense that, you know, they are happening when shear waves are caused and they interfere with each other. And I wanted to share a video with you which I have not done. I will do so shortly. There's another kind of waves called the Rayleigh waves. But since this is not a very detailed course on seismic engineering, I am not going to go into the other waves. What we need to know, primary waves, secondary waves are there, and then we can measure the way these waves behave. Okay, so we saw that there's something called fault, and this is something which I want you to do a little bit of research on. What are the types of faults? So if you are able to see, suppose it has slipped, and you can study the impact of the earthquakes which happened because of that. Now, if you are in a position to say that a slip kind of fault is going to occur, then we are in a very good position to predict what kind of effect is going to happen. So if I know the effect, I am going to construct or, you know, do my buildings in a manner that my urban space doesn't get very affected by the earthquake. The second thing I can do, if I am going to make a big plan, like for example, Amaravati is a new city which is coming up. When I am doing my development control rules, I will ensure that my development is in such a way that the loss due to earthquake is minimum. Okay? So this is the reason why we are interested to study about faults in a particular area. Then there is something called the hypocenter, where the earthquake actually originates. And whatever is perpendicular up is called the epicenter. So the focus of the earthquake is the place where it originates. So there can be slips, there can be faults and other things, and these waves propagate. So in two ways, the primary wave and the secondary wave. So you can have a seismogram which gives a plot of the oscillations which you see. Okay, so it depends on the direction in which the seismogram is placed. A lot of things go into this science. Okay, but what is the takeaway for you guys? Since this is a collection of spectra, this is a collection of frequency plots, vibration plots, you can form spectras. What is the spectra? It's going to say in which area, which band of frequencies, energy content is very high. So these are all this is one of the biggest areas where we structural engineers try to do research. Okay, one of the areas where we do research. Okay, so then we again saw the waves originate from the focus, go to the surface, and then we get surface waves, and there are some harmonics in it. Okay, so this how is this harmonics happening is something we will try to see in this class. In the next class, we will see the actual effect on a building. Okay. Now, we see that there is reflection, refraction, and this wave is essentially a vibration. The wave is essentially a vibration, which I can plot. Okay. Now, can anyone, 10 rupees to the person, who's going to tell me what are the things you do in a sonometer? What are the factors that the vibration depends on in a sonometer? 10 rupees outright, right now. Come on, you can try it. I know 10 rupees is a very small thing. I don't want to raise this one too high. What are the things you do in a stretch string? Okay, let me put it this way. The properties of the stretch string depends on A, B, C. What is A? Tension in the string, then? What is the string constant? Yeah, K depends on. Yeah, tension in the string, very good. Then, mass of the material which makes up the string. I'll give you the third chance also so that I can give you the 10 rupees. Material, tension, vibrating length. Excellent. Okay, so these are the three parameters with which we actually work on. Oh, okay, and guys, stiffness, I'm going to change this a little bit. The tension in the string is otherwise stiffness. If the tension is very high, I cannot pull the string laterally. See, just imagine there's a string, I am pulling it very tightly. Then when I'm trying to pull it in the transverse direction, it's very difficult. Can you see? If I'm going to try to pull the string in the transverse direction, it's very difficult. So it means this is stiffness. Now compare it to the other example I gave you, ballpoint pen spring and a spring from a railway compartment. Which is more stiff? So if the stiffness is more, the energy content will automatically be having a relationship. This relationship is what I want you to visualize. The next thing is the density of material. If the material is very dense, what happens? It is directly proportional or inversely proportional? The frequency of vibration is directly proportional, inversely proportional? Inversely proportional? Anybody directly proportional? Then there is also the vibrating length. Okay, so all these three parameters are only what we study in vibration. Okay, whenever something is vibrating, you will be able to put it in one of these three parameters. Maybe if it's an atoms model which you are studying in vibration, there will be an equivalent to stiffness in the same. There will be equivalent to density, there will be an equivalent to vibrating length. So when you study these in detail, you will be able to get a relationship. But as of now, I just want to excite your imagination to the possibility, and I'm trying to relate some of the concepts which we studied earlier to what we're going to do now. Okay. Now, these are the three things which we usually study in a wave. We know all the waves have wavelength. If you're an electronic student, definitely you will know this, right? Your FM radio, AM radio, name it. You tune it to a particular wavelength. Okay. Suppose the amplitude is very good, then the reception is very, very clear. And after beyond it, yeah, then there is the frequency, number of times you are going to have the whole thing vibrate. So that's why, I mean, like you will have it in the thing like so many megahertz and other things. Now look here, when will the damage to a structure be more? When the amplitude is more or when the amplitude is less? When the amplitude is more, automatically your damage is going to be very high. Second thing, this is the most important thing what I can control as an engineer. The frequency of my building. Don't think I can control the frequency of the earthquake. That is not something which I can do. But what I can do, I can control the frequency of my building. So there is something called resonance. So when you took the sonometer, you took a tuning fork, and then you kept it to find out at what length, vibrating length, for that given material and tension, I get maximum response. Okay, I am using a different word, I am using the word response. When the response is large, what happens? The amplitude automatically becomes very large, the paper rider jumps off. Okay, the paper rider jumps off the stretch string. Now, this is what happens. Suppose the amplitude of vibration of my building matches the ground's vibration. Okay, then my building probably is going to jump off the foundation with joy. Array, the earthquake is at the same frequency as what I am doing. Now, what I can do, if I am going to construct a building, I can find out what is the probable frequency with which the earthquake is going to attack my building site. Agree? Because the layers of material, the properties are not going to change. We are going to at the most give a foundation 3 or 4 meters, and 20-25 meters below is where your earthquake is going to originate, and these layers are the layers through which my shock waves are going to travel. So I can find out what is the frequency with which my earthquake is going to attack my structure. So based on that, I try my best to avoid keeping the frequency close. Okay, so this probably is the thing where engineering is happening. You guys don't need to understand how this calculation is done to see the frequency. But what you can do, can I keep the stiffness of my building in such a manner that the frequency which it will vibrate will not match.
Okay.
So when you are looking at a structure, at least you should be able to think what could be the ways by which I can change the frequency of the building. Okay. So now these fundamental principles of what you call as, you know, this will be the fundamental principles of seismology which we will be looking at. My frequency of the earthquake, okay, the frequency which the earthquake is going to attack, it should not match the frequency of my building. I will be able to generate a lot of spectral plots. Okay, so in that plot I can capture what kind of energy content I'm looking at. Okay, and then I'm going to try to see if this energy comes on this incident on this building, what is going to happen to the building. So these are all some of the very broad things I'm putting across to you. Guys, do you have any questions in what we have done till now? Any questions, please? Do you find it fascinating that, you know, what you studied in 10th standard is getting applied here? Yes, no, maybe? Thank you. Now, I'm not going to introduce you, you know this guy very well. So suppose you come and meet me 2 years after your course. Sir, I was a student in NDMM, probably I'll scratch my head. Oh really, I'll smile and say, yes, nice to meet you, then I'll ask what's your name. Okay, this is what we guys are going to do. There's a person you know by the name Standing Wave. Okay, anybody remembering what Standing Wave is? Okay, now, we introduced Standing Wave at the beginning of this class. The standing wave is where I take the bed sheet and shake it. The particles have amplitude, they oscillate with a specific frequency, but they don't translate, they don't move. Example, you take a stone, put it in a pond. The leaves on the pond, the dust on the particles on the pond vibrate. The energy moves from the point where the stone hit the water, it comes out. But then what happens? All the stuff is just moving up and down. This is a standing wave. Now look what happens when a standing wave is there. It propagates. There is an excitation. It propagates. Then it again starts to come back. Okay. The wave starts, then it comes back. Okay. Now suppose you look at the waves, you get a series of harmonics. You get a series of harmonics. In fact, in most of your analog circuits which you design, you try to avoid harmonics. For some cases you may want harmonics, for others you don't want harmonics, okay? Because they tend to, but for us what happens is, under certain circumstances, these harmonics start to play with the frequency with which my building is going to vibrate. Okay, so we kind of are just trying to be aware that there is something called harmonics which can cause some damage to your building. Okay, end of the day, all your calculation, you know, whatever we do, it all comes to Newton's second law. Okay, force is equal to mass into acceleration. Okay, so we are seeing that the particles are getting accelerated and the building has a mass. So what are the force with which the, I mean, what are the extra force the building has to take? Okay, now that part is a little bit of being in depth. Okay, you guys need to remember that there is a frequency content in the earthquake, there is a natural frequency of the building, these two should not match. Okay, now there is something called fundamental natural frequency. What is fundamental natural frequency? Can you guys Google up fundamental natural frequency, please? See, in a flute or something, you'd have studied this. There will be a note. I mean, this is a string. In a flute, you'd have had at the open end there is an anti note. At the this one, there's a note. Okay, and okay, what is natural frequency? Fundamental natural frequency? Anybody? Yes, the last one, please. What is fundamental natural frequency? Google it up. Please Google it up. Yeah. The other one, the first one, yes. Yes, the one in the black shirt. What is fundamental natural frequency, please? Yes, what is it?
The value of frequency at which the particle oscillates without any traveling or damping.
First frequency, okay, the first frequency. We are very much interested in the first frequency because the first frequency has the highest amplitude. Amplitude is maximum in the first natural frequency. The subsequent natural frequencies, there are, in fact, for a building, there are infinite number of natural frequencies. But the energy content for the subsequent natural frequencies is much lesser. Okay. Now, I just want you to see this damage to a building. This was taken in Mexico.
Yeah, this was a Mexican building, not very nice to see.
So this is something like literally that destroyed in seconds, right? Okay, this happened because of a wrong way by which construction is being done, called soft stories. What essentially happens, there is a change in stiffness. Here the mass and other things are very, very less. When you go higher up, the stiffness increases. Okay, what is stiffness? The you know, like to cause it to move slightly, you need a lot of energy. But at the bottom, it is very, very easy. So when the whole thing starts to shake, the bottom part of the building or the stilt parking areas start to take too much of energy and then they fall. Okay. So I am going to show you another video. This video is, you watch the video, then we will discuss this. This is a very, very, very famous video. What actually happened in this building? What did you observe in this bridge? This bridge is Tacoma Narrows, okay, in the US. Some of the parts of this video, particular video, was definitely re-engineered, but the original video has most of this content, and then they have added color to this. Okay, they have added color to this particular video. Now, what happened in this bridge? That span which you saw is actually concrete. Okay. And this bridge had very low frequency waves, low velocity waves passed it. And this started to cause it to flutter. The natural frequency of the waves caused because of this wind passing across the bridge generated waves which matched the natural frequency of the bridge. So can you see the response which the bridge had when natural frequencies matched, right? So this is the effect of an earthquake also when it is going to be having a frequency content which matches the frequency of the structure. Okay, when the frequency of the structure matches the frequency of the earthquake, then this is what is going to happen. Large deformations are going to happen, and then there is also going to be failure. Okay, so guys, take home for today. I want you to try to understand how amplitude, frequency, and mass are going to influence vibration. Okay, how mass, stiffness of a building is being determined, right? So can you think how mass is going to be, what is going to be the way mass is going to be there in a structure? So this is probably one of the things which I am throwing out to you as a challenge. Okay, and in the previous class we had asked you to think a little bit about the way by which the waves behave. That is, there is an excitation, waves travel through a medium, they reflect, they refract, and then they get a whole set of content. Okay, usually what we do is we try to break all this chaotic motion into simple harmonic motion. Okay, so and then when we get the then it becomes very easy for us to do our work. Okay, so in math, in most of your wave transformation like Fourier transformation and other things, do you remember you always used to have the word simple harmonic motion in your problems? I hope they asked it that way. So if you go through some of the techniques, mostly you find that simple harmonic motion is being used. Okay, so you'll find that all those transformations which you use, all of them are aimed at helping you to capture the random, from the randomness in the plot to something which you can measure. You get a spectrum and then you do your work. Okay. Any questions, please? Guys, try to ask questions in the class. Maybe from the previous class, if you ask me questions, maybe at the most I may not know the answer. And if you ask me a question, I'll not put it back to you. Okay, I want to ensure that you guys think, apply your mind when you come to this class or do this course. You are very simply doing only the repeat of what you have done in the previous class, previous years. Okay, maybe from school time. Okay, so if there's no questions, we will stop the lecture for now.